Thanks for coming out, everybody. I prefer to take the opportunity to work out that I can. I tell you what, it's always been a dream of mine to come to work and wear all that gear at the same time. Yesterday was kind of funny. We were here and the audiovisual guy was up front with me. And we were looking out, making sure everything was ready to go. And he's watching the video, and he sees me kind of serious about the setup, and he's like, I said, we're going to have a fight on stage, me and that guy, tomorrow right now. He was like, cool. I don't know if we have the insurance for that, but he went with it anyway. Listen, you guys can have a big 2012, say yeah!
Yeah!
Listen, we are dedicated with Crush It to educate, motivate, and challenge you as agents. We came about the concept specifically called Horizons Agents, but we are inviting everyone. The commitment is to be here quarterly. It's to have amazing speakers. Next year, I have top entrepreneurs planned to be here. People that have risen to the ranks, done amazing things, have amazing stories to give you more, to understand how their minds work. My goal with these events isn't to make you better salespeople. Every coach and their brother is going to come through. A lot of them have good information, but I believe it's about being better business people. Crush It events are geared towards pushing Horizons agents, pushing the rest of you towards being better business people. People can be better salespeople, but if you are a better business person, you will be an infinitely better salesperson. Being a salesperson is one piece of a much more complete arena of concepts for you as a business person. Now, today we have Richard Lee on deck. Richard Lee always comes with something interesting. Yay. He knows the business media as well. Yeah, he's full of insight. Vice President from First American. Knows Las Vegas very well. Now, we also will have Brian Hout, my department manager from Horizon, runs our short sale department, which is between 180 and 200 units right now. Now we have Brandy Whiteout. We have some very sharp short sale prowess, some information. And I'm going to hit them with questions that I want to know the answers to. I'm going to put them on the spot with information that will help you. And when I tell you the vision for 2012, you're going to understand why what they say makes sense and is important to you. Okay? We have some social media experts on deck, which are a blast. We as agents are highly technical. A lot of times I see an agent stumbling through the office, and I pair them up with our IT guy because their computer doesn't work. I overheard one the other day. The IT guy says, well, what operating system are you running? And the agent says, electricity, I think. I just plug it into the wall. And I'm shaking my head saying, that's not what he's talking about. But we have technology. Some of it's mutated and some of it hasn't. I was watching everybody come in today. Technology hasn't advanced far enough in many areas. But a lot of you have the earpieces on today where the speaker is in your ear hole and the bottom of the microphone is next to your earlobe. You might ever have fun talking to someone on one of those these days? It's like, what did you say? Like, I'm sorry, the vibrations of your jaw aren't coming through. And so my apologies. Because technology hasn't really caught up. Social media is important. It's hugely important for your business next year. We have NAC, which is a social media company out of California. Christine and Nikki are my personal consultants, have been for several months, have pushed thousands of viewers to our Facebook and our Twitter, and have absolutely revolutionized how we do business there. You hear from them today, completely exciting stuff. Agents don't quite have their mind wrapped around social media either. How many of you saw this event on Facebook at all? Hey, how many just, at least you either were convinced to come here, you saw on Facebook, several hands went up. Brandon, by the way, can you bring some water down? I am. How's the workout getting down here? But agents haven't figured out social media all the way. I saw someone the other day on Facebook, I'll keep them anonymous, John Smith. We're media, we're news hounds, right? Our news has to be instantaneous these days. So here was the press. It's John Smith is making a sandwich. You're going, wow, that is really important that you push that out there. John Smith. And then a couple minutes later, thank you, Brian. John Smith puts a picture on his McFish sandwich on his Facebook page. Right? Very business relevant. Then the kicker, I love this. At the very end, John Smith liked his own statement about the McFish sandwich. What is that about? Right? So Next year, look for more. I'm going to have a little bit more insight on March. March 15th is the next event. We're going to take it very seriously every single time. Only good information packed in 2 hours' time. Your heads will explode with information. You will have a plan. And by the way, planning and what you're going to get today is simple. If you'll permit me, I'm going to give you what works in my business. I'm going to share with you my vision for 2012, and I'm going to put the most practical, common sense things into your business so that you can understand how to tackle 2012, if you'll permit me. Well, let me start. There's a proverb that says, without a vision, the people perish. So it's important that you understand what you're planning for in 2012. Let's talk about the national stage. I had the good fortune last week at a CEO group that I'm a part of to sit down and hear from a best-selling author, a well-known conservative economist, a businessman's economist, which means we can say in our minds and our, what we want to do in here is to get it to a straight. Brian Bolu is his name. Brian Bolu, you search him, he's out there. He is the CEO of Integrated Trend Research. And Brian says, and he's not rose-colored glasses Brian, he's a realistic guy, comes out and says that next year, the national outlook is good. Yes, we are in recovery, but it'll be slow and improved recovery. Why? Commercial banks are lending more. There is more liquidity. If you look at the monetary, the M2, the stats actually rate the amount of cash flow that's available. There's a lot available. We're going to have continued leading indicators that are up, leading indicators such as how much we import, how much we export. Things of that nature will continue to look up next year. Federal government will continue deficit spending. Woo-hoo! Whether we think that's a practical business move, it will improve the economy nonetheless, right? Housing demand is showing signs. A lot of indicators out that show that housing is going to be continuing to improve. Let me tell you this on a national level in terms of some plans for your business. One thing that this economist who has nothing to do was not speaking to a group of realtors. In fact, the only two realtors in that room were me and Mark Stark, who owns Prudential. When he was talking to a room full of businessmen, he said, and I quote, in 2007, I told you all to get out of debt, shed the fat, lean your operations. Because if you don't, as we go forward past 2007, you will crash. He also made the statement that said, this last past time, he said, listen, welcome me back. I tell you what's changed since 2007. I'm going to tell you today to go out and borrow money. Go out and borrow money. You don't want to borrow money because I trained you not to borrow it. 2007, I told you to shed it. He said, go out and borrow money. Why? Because we're going into an inflationary era. 2012 is something you know. Money's going to inflate. People that have the ability to buy real estate can buy real estate with leveraged money and pay it back with a cheaper dollar. Now, none of us in this world that we live in now can grasp that mentality, but that's what the economists say. And if you think it through, that is reality. People ought to be buying real estate. They logically are. Investor demand is peaking in a major way. But he said, do things like borrow money. Borrow it now. Don't borrow like the federal government. Do it once, strategically, so to speak. You borrow the money. You diversify your business. You invest in your business. You go into dividend-bearing stocks. His idea of that was take some of that money and buy dividend. He said 50% of your money, if you're going to play with dividend-paying stocks, should go overseas to countries that have positive demographics. That means they're growing, and their actual economic structure is improving. There are other positive demographic outside countries that he liked, such as Canada, New Zealand, just several different countries you can look at to do that. But when we come into an inflationary era, inflation favors the debtor, it does not favor the lender. Inflation does not favor the tenant, it favors the landlord. Now, the interesting thing about this guy who does not advocate wholesale pushing of real estate, we weren't realtors in the room, said, that is the case, buy residential and buy it now and borrow as much as you can to buy it. The future in our world is landlords, not homeowners. Whether I agree with that or not, and whether you agree with that or not, that's not the point. The point is, do we see the validity and more landlords coming into this market, yes or no?
Yes. Yes.
We do see that. It's all over the place. It's epic. In fact, I don't think I've ever seen investors lower their standards than like I have recently. Someone yesterday, a friend of mine, gave me a referral to a to an investor with a lot of cash, and I'm thinking, we have 18 levels and barriers because this scrupulous God is going to put me through the ringer. It was like, give me something, four walls and a deed, you know? I am in. So we're going to come into that next year. Let's speak to Nevada specifically. How many were you on the teleconference call for the AB-284 bill? Good. Okay, there's very few. So I'm going to take this to the seventh grade level, but I'll keep it pithy because many of you are associating the AB-284 bill, the assembly bill that came out of Nevada, as the robo-signing bill or that's the cause of action. That's what people in our world associate that to. But this particular bill is relevant to Nevada because it was crafted and passed around June, if I'm not mistaken. October, its effects were felt into our economy immediately. We have anywhere from 2,000 to 4,000 NODs given a month, okay? That means foreclosure starts are filed, people are put into this gauntlet where they are put into a position where they're eventually going to have their home taken by the lien holder, okay? So what happened with AB-284? Many of you heard the story. October 1st, due to the bill and its requirements on the lien holders, they stopped foreclosing, okay? There were some commercial filings, but really in terms of lien holders pulling houses, it's almost zero. They went from like up here to down here. And so with that is a pattern that's happened since October 1st till today. Now, I've been hearing rumblings through my contacts in the trustee realm that we have trustee sales coming again. Maybe this week, maybe next, maybe January. It's bad karma to send out a NOD around Christmas, in my opinion, even though it's not really gonna happen for 4 more months. But there's a lot of that hitting a break right now. You know, Grinch goes and does something different during the holiday season. But with this AB-284, if best case scenario, we resume foreclosure starts in January, then we won't have foreclosures from that until spring, mid to late spring. You won't have that inventory coming to the market until mid to late summer. I've heard all kinds of, you might have seen, you know, Brian Lebo put out a video. This is bad. Then Todd Miller put out a video. This is not bad. We got more than enough to go around. It's going to be okay. And he actually defied the actual school of thought here is this, okay? At best, we're going to have a period of time where these, so far it's been 3 months, where NODs have stopped, where the actual bank owns the distressed property arena will have those foreclosure starts that didn't happen starting in October, won't come out into the market in February in terms of actually having foreclosures take place. The bank owns eventually follow in March and April. So that being the case, the school of thought is if that does happen, then that REO volume will shrink. Todd Miller's school of thought is that we have this huge yarn ball of NODs, and I like Todd Miller, and I'm not saying either one of these quotes are right or wrong. I mean that in the court. But he said that, here's the thing, there's so many NODs that have already been filed that even though we don't have any new NODs starting, this yarn ball of properties that were started in foreclosure before this bill was passed, they were brought to the sale, but then the sale was canceled or postponed. Lots and lots of homes, thousands of homes. You want my opinion, I'll give that to you. It's this. My opinion is, I believe that, and being a realist and helping you guys plan, okay? I believe REO volume will be down dramatically next year, okay? This is Jared Jones making his own plans, right? That might affect my business a little, huh? So in terms of that, REO will be down. When you look at your own business, what do we have left? Well, we know what that is, okay? At best, there will be a trickle through the system. There will be the little letting out of that yarn ball that Todd Miller brings up. The problem with the yarn ball is the yarn ball was postponed for a reason. Bankruptcy. HAFA was started. Someone was trying to short sell somewhere. Banks have their own procedure that says, if you submit a HAFA, the brakes stop. You've never had this happen, right? It's a widespread process. So if that be the case, some things you need to know about Nevada next year is that REO activity will most likely diminish greatly late spring. And all of the challenges that go with that, okay? Your listings, by the way, And I'm a believer that when one door closes, another opens. You know, when I told this to my team, they were like, why the heck? What are you going to do? Well, no. One opportunity, one door closes, the other one opens. What happens? Well, your listings will sell faster. Okay? No matter what it is, it'll sell faster. The supply will negate that your listings will go. The buyers will buy. These buyers that are with you right now that don't listen, and you say, come in at this, they will listen. It also means you're going to be disciplined in your decision-making for the buyers you're choosing next year. You're going to be decisioning all of those different buyers by who's going to take and listen to what you're going to have to say when it comes to the market. Price tension will be upward. We all know what happens when prices go up when you work in a commission business. That's a positive sign. How high will it go? I don't know. Has to have a long-term tension for actually be any real credible spikes. But I think it's very logical to think that a lot of your homes, the ones you're selling now that are 100 grand or 110, maybe more 130 or 150, which is a nice difference in your commission. Your clients on the sidelines need to get in now. If you have cash buyers that are treading the water, they need to understand that the landscape for them is going to be probably a little bit more tense even going forward. Flipping by itself, there'll be a point when flipping will be extremely challenging. Right now, if you have a buyer who, or an investor who wants to flip, they own a home going into a time when supply is tense, you're going to get rid of it pretty fast. Not a problem. But there'll be a point when if they want to re-enter the market, flipping will be very challenging. But who cares? Investors got the word. The word is that Vegas is very high on the scale. In fact, I think we're number one in the Trulia report. It says that what you pay for a price on a home and what you'll get in return from the actual cash flow versus the mortgage carrying cost or just buying it are amazingly good in Las Vegas. Signs of overcorrection, right? Your entry point came so low that you can actually buy, and it makes a ton of sense from a monetary standpoint. We have a ton of people in our business, in our environment now. Last month, we had record sales with our bidding at a trustee sale. Our auction guys were slammed. They were down there every single day buying homes because investors are going, yeah, find me a deal, buy me something. I need 80 cents on the dollar. I want it to be in this particular range, and we're buying every single day. And the realtors will benefit from that. One thing that Brian Bolu said that I think makes a ton of sense for the future of our economy is that if you are sticking around in Las Vegas, and he didn't say just about being a realtor, but he said you must export your services. The future of Vegas is service-based, good for us, and it's exporting it. That means you're not working with the people inside. You're not changing and exchanging services on a consistent basis with our local friends. Because that pond is much smaller, and if you want to think big and you want to crush it next year, you need a buyer who's not looking for one, but looking for 10 to buy. When you do that, that is going to stretch you. You're going to be someone different to do that. And the reality is, we think we want our fair share of the business. We want an unfair share of the business. And if you want to win next year, exporting your services has to be a part of this. A friend of mine is a local president of a development company in town. And a lot of times when I consult, try to find money and stuff like that for auctions or whatever else, I'm talking to him. I say, and he's very financially backed, he's very sharp. His mind works that way, and he has a lot of contacts on the East Coast. I said, Todd, what's going on? He said, man, I'm speaking to Wall Street, we're speaking to a prominent money manager, and if I said the name, you'd know it, Minnie. He said, he asked the money manager, how much of this money you guys are managing over, you know, in your venue, how much of that money is in real estate? He said, Todd, it's probably less than 5%. Maybe 10, maybe 10%. He said, I got this guy in Vegas, he kind of explained what we do. The pushback from this money manager and the concept, and when he asked the next question was, how much do you think makes sense to merge into real estate? The money manager said, look, we can trillions of dollars, trillions of dollars. We can take a 5 to 10% exposure and take the 50%. He says, well, why don't you? He says, real estate professionals, and in general, are challenging to work with. Real estate agents and are challenging to work with. He said, and I disagree, we just don't get it. He says, we're challenged with their aptitude, with their language, with what they think, with what they say. You're talking to people who are used to moving millions of dollars into a specific area to plant. And we are challenged to work with them because of ourselves. Listen, what I want to challenge you, when you export your services, when you grow yourself into next year, it's about bringing yourself to a different level. Reinvention. Where do you need to reinvent yourselves next year? Detroit's a perfect example. A rundown business model turned around, right? You might see the new Chrysler commercial. It says, import from Detroit, right? They're trying to convince us that they have flipped their model so well that they are in competition with the import market. It's interesting, though. Think about Cadillac. Remember Cadillac in the days of old? What did you think about in the days of old if you were, what were you saying to people if you were driving a Cadillac? I'm going to die soon. That's what people think about you. Now what do you say to people? You're telling people that I'm a prominent attorney. I'm an accomplished reality TV star. I'm a musician. I am a professional athlete. Reinvention. Reinvention is a huge idea. Reinvention isn't easy. When you reinvent, you've got to stretch yourself. The simplest fashion that you need to understand about reinvention in your business next year, if you want to be the person that these larger entities, you want to trade out your one buy-at-a-time mom-and-pop buyer, or you want to trade that mid-level investor for a large investor, the trade-offs that you have to give is reinvention in your business. It's constant view on yourself to bring yourself up from a financial understanding, from a vocabulary. Vocabulary is huge, folks. You know that you cue people off when you talk. Vocabulary. Widen your vocabulary. It'll kill your business. Just stick around the right people or listen pattern to the right people. Have a process to improve your vocabulary. Your systems. Is your team running smoothly? Your process of the newest marketing techniques. People want to see you before they see you. That's what today is about, is branching out your version of reinvention. And by the way, people, you got to work at it, okay? Reinvention by itself, we can't stand here and say today that I don't have the time or I don't want to organize myself and change. We're all stuck with the same old process. And I'll tell you, you can't stand in front of a stove and say, stove, give me the heat, and I'll throw the wood in after I'm done. You've got to go into it and push everything you've got, do a complete intellectually honest self-analysis, to bring your leadership quotient, your professional quotients up. With it will go your income. With it will go your production. When we spoke about Brian Bolu's process, all he said about next year, and this is an honest guy, was opportunity is everywhere. Opportunity is out there, and it's bigger in 2012 than it is this year. Are we out of the recession? Come on. It's not, but we're on a progressive upward growth. The trends are showing good signs. I'll tell you this, and you can take this with you, is that if life is tough, next year we'll have a new set of challenges. It is tough, and life is hard, but life can be fun. It can be full of opportunity. And the harder you are on yourself, the easier and the more rewarding life will be. Don't give yourself an out. Don't be easy on yourself on reinvention. Let me tell you another thing when you decide which bucket or which demand pipeline you're going to try to fish for next year. One thing I see agents do a lot is they place their bucket under the wrong demand. They say, I'm going to work at it. I'm going to improve myself. I'm going to go and reinvent my process. And by the way, people oftentimes think it takes money to be successful. You are successful before you have money. You are putting the reinvention time in. You're working hard on yourself to improve what you provide. Buyers, sellers, companies, everybody likes what you do. And so then obviously success brings the payoff. Money is simply a barometer for how good you're doing, folks. But make no mistake, success precedes your payoff for 2012. But when you think about where you should be successful, you take all the energy in the world and you can put your bucket under the wrong demand and see the wrong thing. You say, look at what I'm doing. Look, I challenged myself, I set these goals, I did exactly what you said, Jared. What's going on? Your bucket might be on the right wrong demand. You might be completely underneath a particular segment of our economy, segment of our business industry, and be completely successful. Everyone loves you, But because your bucket is under wrong demand, you have cash flow crunch, you have concerns and issues. Why? Because either there's not an appropriate amount of demand, that means whatever in that business cycle is supposed to be repeating so that you can get a paycheck, is it repeating fast enough, or is it a slow pipeline? Maybe your pipeline's cluttered, right? You have everything is a 180-day pipeline. You probably will not meet your goals, even though you can quantifiably say, I'm successful. I'm successful in what I've done. But your demand and where you've positioned yourself has, even though it's been successful, has been in the wrong place. Decide where you're going to be in the market next year, but make sure that there's an equivalent payoff for what you're going to do. Before we start some of a brief exercise I'm going to do before we pass it on, I want to just push something on you for a moment. And I see so many people, especially at month end, I'm sometimes terrible. Some of my people in the room are like, oh my gosh, Jared shakes the place. And some of you, I see you at month end and you're just broken down. I got to make my Lexus payment soon. Times are tough. Listen, business is great out there. Business is phenomenal out there. 2012, opportunity. The people that watch for opportunity tell us opportunities will be out there next year. If I were to ask you, will people out there, even in our industry, make millions of dollars, would you say yes or yes?
Yes.
You say yes. If there are going to be people in any industry in the world that will even make billions of dollars, not corporations, but just single people, you would say yes. Listen, opportunities are great out there. The world is going to be full of them. But one thing with agents is business is great, but business is bad. Business is bad in here. If business is bad in here, it doesn't matter what's going on outside. Business is good or bad for you, period, based on what you have in your mind. Whatever's in your mind, who you are and what you are, is a symptom of what's gone into your mind. You can change who you are and you can change what you are if you change simply what's gone into your mind. It's a pattern. It's a habit. People would sit here in your seats and prejudice up front.
Jared, he's trying to motivate me. He's trying to force me into a positive mode.
You know what's funny? You took a shower today, right? Yeah. Motivation is as simple as hygiene. And it's equally as important. And I challenge you that if you don't work on a daily basis, if you don't come at it as directly as you do brushing your teeth, it'll be a problem. It'll hinder everything you're trying to do. You can put all the beautiful goals on your paper next year, know exactly where you want to go, but if your mind isn't behind it, you're going to have a problem. The mind is hugely important. If you haven't read Psycho-Cybernetics by Maxwell Maltz, read it. Maxwell Maltz makes an argument that the mind is so strong that wherever you put it on a course, it will take you, period. It's like actually equates it to like a heat-seeking missile, that it's a goal-seeking mechanism by nature. And oftentimes, the shame of our minds are we neglect them because they are free. And anything we get for free, we place an alarmingly low value. And it didn't come with an instruction manual anyways. So we're even more behind where we should be. And I'm going to tell you today, as cheap and cheesy as you might think it is, load your mind up front and work on stringing together days and weeks and series of time where all you do is approach your business and your list of goals in a pattern that is dominating, confident, and positive towards where you want to be. Why? Well, you're my peers and you wouldn't sit here if you wanted things to stay the same. But you have to learn the mind. There, folks, read The Theory of 21. The Theory of 21 is a modern day book. Psycho-Cybernetics is not. Also a great thinking book for the modern era. The author of The Theory of 21, which by the way, The Theory of 21 has nothing to do with blackjack, but The Theory of 21 talks about 21s. Talks about how to juice up the creative mind, how to fire you up into a mode of thinking that puts you on a pattern for success. It also brings you to awareness of all these other thinking patterns that work around you. After I read that book, one of the things that I took out of it is that I have to be careful. I have to be careful when I'm not in a role thinking about myself. You know, when I'm thinking about myself, I've gone through all the routines. I'm going to share some simple ones with you today. To say, you know what? I'm going to keep myself on the track. I'm going to fight, I'm going to pull together and do what I'm supposed to do. But when it comes to other people's goals, someone comes up to me and says, hey, Jared, I'm going to do this. Another prominent leader in the industry in Vegas, came up to me about 2 months ago. It says, Jared, I'm going to open a mortgage company. I said, what? Stand in my good ear. I'm going to open a mortgage company. My inclination, my knee-jerk reaction, and I'm out of care for this guy, would have been, are you out of your mind? That could be the furthest from a great idea, but I did it. It's a difference. And the reality is, we are sabotaging sometimes our own thoughts, but sometimes those of others. Reading that book is an amazing venue. You should try it. When you proceed to push towards 2012, and I'm going to be through in a minute, you got to think about what track you're going to follow. The numbers show us that less than 5 to 6% of anyone write down long-term goals. That means chances are if there's 100 or 110 of you, that less than probably 10 of you know where you want to be in 2015. Isn't that interesting? This study's also shown in the reverse that the rest of the crowd is doing extremely well. But what pattern should we follow in that? Once we do that, what should we do the following day after we set these long-range goals? It's hard to think about 2015 when you're looking at Friday. It's hard to think about 2015 when you're starting January 1st of 2012. How do you eat the elephant, right? I'm going to give you some tips on doing that today. Tiger Woods, one of the winningest golfers in the world. An amazing shot. You ever watch an exhibition with Tiger Woods? On the range, it's amazing. They'll put big old, you know, obstacles in front of them, signs and towers and all that stuff, and they'll put a pin 250 yards out. And he'll fly the ball around the stupid sign and hit the pin. And as half as well, looking like he, you know, really could have shot it with his, you know, with just back turn. It was just simple. The reality is, I've been playing golf for probably a couple of years now, and recently I've been taking lessons. Probably about 6 months with lessons. And I would tell you this, that if I were to take you out on the driving range, and I were to take Tiger Woods with me, we would all go out to the range. And if I spend 20 minutes with you, I could have you outscoring Tiger on the range in just 20 simple minutes. Provided we blindfold Tiger Woods. And we spin him around for about 5 minutes till he throws up or falls on the ground. And you'd say, Tiger, how are you going to hit that shot? You can't see the pen. And I would tell all of you, how are you going to hit your goal in 2012 that you don't have? How do you hit a goal you don't have? If the numbers say that less than 5 or 6% of us don't know where we're going to be in 2015, what are we going to do about it? Realtors are a funny bunch, aren't we? I'm just like you. If I'm out there on a sale or if I'm on the phone with a client, half the time, if I'm driving around in my car or working with someone, I'm thinking about home. I'm thinking about my family. Or I'm distant. And then if I'm at home, all I can think about is being back on the job. I think about a call I didn't make. Anyone like that? You're always back and you're shifting. You hear agents and you talk about goals, and oftentimes they say, Jared, how do we do all that? I don't have enough time. You hear that a lot. Listen, there is no shortage of time. There's only a shortage of direction. Realtors and salespeople often get muddled over what is important and what isn't important. Right? We're back and forth. What do we do next? The shame of it is, what makes it harder is that people that actually see patients, for instance, doctors, they're a self-employed professional, guess what? They have a schedule. They walk in and they're going to see people and they're going to produce cash flow because their schedule dictates them to do that. If you were to actually have a full schedule, if you were to be on a job or hitting a clock, most of the time, if that was your position, you may not necessarily need such a defined purpose to get you through the year. But I'll tell you, as agents, me being the first, you absolutely have to structure direction. We don't get it. Everyone I know in our business, when we get so scattered, I got a good friend that I laugh. We do laugh sometimes because he is like a chandelier. He is an absolutely bright light, but it's broken up and it's pretty and it's all over the place. And all he needs to do is channel in one direction and he's cutting like a laser. Right. But are we chandeliers or are we lasers? Listen, I want to take you through a quick vision step real quick. We're going to do it today. I'm going to absolutely force you to do something right now in pairs. What you have in your hands, a vision exam, okay? The vision exam is important. Jerry, did you do this with someone?
Yes, I did.
Do you do that often?
Yes, I do. I actually do it every 6 months. I redo them.
You have a vision exam. You're probably given a pencil. Take out your pencil and take out your vision exam. Here's what you're going to do. We're going to take a 3-minute break. If I see people really working through this, it might take 5. Here's the reality. 2015 is the first question. 2015, guys, is not a volume revenue question. You guys get that, right?
I need to sell 1,000 homes in 2015.
We don't even know what the market looks like in 2015. We worry about 2012. Volume, commission, our goals for next year. 2015 is a what did you sweat off of your business between now and then? Whenever you touch anything in the real estate industry or any job you control, you should have something to show for it at the end, right? You should have, in 2015, a personal lifestyle goal, a personal development process, generally in the investment arena, right? Unless you want to work forever. Which, by the way, I mean, if you have fun, who cares? But it wouldn't be nice to make those decisions on your own will? 2015 is, how many homes do you want to own in cash flow? 2015 might be the size of your net worth. And by the way, I am a BHAG believer. B-H-A-G, big, hairy, audacious goal believer. You would say, what is that? Well, that means you think this through and you think big. Then you think audaciously. You come up with the wildest thing that you can possibly think of. Then you add hair to it. Okay? The way you add hair to it is usually short the time. When you add hair, you tweak. Well, I was going to give myself 6 months to do that. You do it, yeah, great. It's hard. You know? It's when you push yourself. You push yourself. The outside world that doesn't have, that clocks into work every day. The way they move up the ladder is they don't get promoted. They become too big for the job they're in. When you're self-employed, nothing changes. Self-employment is about becoming bigger than the job you're in. It's reinvention. It is absolutely a process of improving your mindset, the type of mind you run, how you run your mind, putting it to work for you. And it's a process of knowing where you're going. Today, we're going to take 2 minutes, maybe 2 to 5 minute range, pair up with someone. If you're sitting next to a stranger, work with them. If you don't think they have anything to offer, I guarantee you, 5 minutes from now, you will think differently. Everybody has something to offer the other person. Think it through, be as open and honest as you want to be, and go ahead and start right now.